This video is sponsored by Unity. Recently, Unity introduced a long-awaited feature to Universal Render Pipeline.
By the way, I'm so f***ing fanboying about URP right now. Are you seeing those juicy FPS numbers? Just look at that performance! Look at that!
A feature called camera stacking, which allows us to combine the output of multiple cameras to achieve complex effects in a matter of seconds. Christine from Unity already did a fantastic job explaining how it's used in just under a few minutes. I'll leave the link in the description. And for more URP stuff, be sure to check out Unity's video library right here on YouTube. In just a minute, I will be getting full on with camera stacking myself. But what I wanted to particularly do with this video is to take a break from my own stuff. And try out a new format, where I'll be exploring a single Unity feature in isolation, treating it as a one-man game jam sort of a thing, with the goal of finding unique approaches to prototyping iteration and maybe finding some interesting use cases along the way. So, here goes. In Universal Render Pipeline Examples project, hosted on GitHub, Unity demonstrates a few ways this feature could be applied. Use camera stacking to take your UIs to the next level by rendering 3D objects right into the in-game pop-up windows. Create vehicle or mech cockpits by rendering them separately, as shown in this example. And my personal favorite, use multiple cameras to create an illusion that the game world is much larger than it actually is. I highly recommend you check out this example project, as it contains so much value beyond what I've highlighted already. With that out of the way, let's create something stupid. I start off with a fresh project and populate it with a few assets like Unity's own recorder to help me capture gameplay footage and the Polygon 3D City Pack to use for my visuals. Links are in the description. Next, I try to set up camera stacking for the first time myself, and turns out it's just a matter of few clicks. Duplicate your camera, change its rendering type and assign it to the first camera stack. I don't know what else I was expecting. One of the cameras has a simple camera controller script attached to it, which comes default with Unity. So by click-dragging my mouse around, we're able to see the stacking in all its glory. Granted, what I have right now is just the same single model rendered on top of itself, but we'll get there. Camera stacking has a cool setting, which allows you to keep the depth information from the previous layer, which in turn makes overlaid cameras test against the depth buffer and draw objects not on top, but as if they were rendered in a single pass, together. This in turn results in an interesting visual effect, where the objects that are seemingly in the same scene have their lighting applied from different angles. I'm sure this can be used in a creative way, and I'll let you figure out some cool use cases for this. But I'm moving on, cause I think I figured out what I want to test exactly. What if I leave both cameras at the same position, but instead rotate one of the cars, and by figuring out the difference in angles, I can draw an overlay the closer we are to the target position, creating a simple mini game of matching rotations. Or I could simply demonstrate. Saying this out loud sounds far more convoluted. I first create a script to rotate the object in the scene. And then I create a simple outline shader based on the Fresnel node for my ghostly target car. And although the part started to work the way I was imagining it, I also realized that this is in fact not really that a creative or fun way of using camera stacking. Sure, I apply it here to achieve a result, but same result could be easily achieved with regular objects or renderer features. So, the decision to trash this must be made. Let me just quickly wrap what I have started, just to make sure how exactly terrible this idea is. And yes, this is opposite of fun. Lesson learned, not every seemingly good idea is a nugget. Moving on. For my next trick, I decided to use another asset from the store, cause I felt like playing with some rocks, I guess. By the way, in just a couple of days, starting November 17th, the Unity Asset Store will be having its biggest sale of the year, with tons of assets discounted up to 70% off. Be sure not to miss it. This time, the idea is to build a scene containing two copies of the same geometry, but a different scale, so that when they are overlaid, the physics happening inside those copies will behave differently, while still occupying the same space. Once again, I feel like trying to explain it just complicates things more than necessary. Let me show instead. So I set up a simple scene and make a copy of everything, including the camera, and scale it all 5 times. Just as before, I convert the second camera to overlay and set it up in the main camera stack. I make the world's simplest script to sync both cameras' position and rotation. And what I end up with is a level with 2 sets of identical scenery, rendered on top of each other. So now, when I proceed to add simple rigid body spheres to each of the copies, they should fall with different speeds, but still appear as part of the same image. What I get instead, though, is just wrong. Cause not only will I have better results and control if I'll just change physics properties per object, but now one of the balls doesn't even cast any shadows, because remember, it's as if it's from another dimension. Needless to say, as fun as this idea was in my head, it's as grotesque when it comes to actually realizing it this way. Alright, so let me... I forgot. The city pack asset, I used the car from earlier, comes with legacy materials that do not work in URP. That can be usually fixed by swapping out the old shader for the newer one, and every parameter should just remap itself as long as the shader properties have the same names. But in this case, not all of the properties are named that way, so I resort to just creating my own transport shader to handle the transition. While past me is preparing the scene, I'll try to explain one more please God work this time idea. Remember how in earlier example I used 2 cameras and sync their rotation? Well, what if I'll use even more cameras in the stack but delay their inputs gradually, creating sort of a trailing effect? So I begin by creating 4 cameras in total, as well as setting up additional layers and assigning them to each of the stacked camera's culling mask, which makes them only render those particular objects. The idea is to separate the scene geometry into layers by distance from the camera in a cascading manner, not unlike the Unity's built-in shadow cascade feature. With all the cameras in place, I go into my trusty VS Code and cook up a simple script that checks for colliders in the scene based on the radius from the camera. You could, of course, just iterate over all the objects in the scene and check the distance to their center or bounding box or whatever, but this is my piece of so I make the rules. Once the objects are found, they are put into one of the layers created earlier. Don't mind me setting one of the cameras in the stack twice here, it's a brain fart, not a stroke of brilliance. I make sure to disable the post-processing for every camera except the last one in the stack, so that I won't get multiplied results. Now, it's time to drag the script on each of the stacked cameras and customize the parameters. Each camera in our setup will use the one above it as its target, that way we should have cameras follow each other smoothly. Okay, almost there. Just need to create a helper script to call the camera methods in succession, otherwise some layers can be overridden if they are run out of order. Silly me, forgot to assign the camera to the script I just wrote. And we're off. To be frank, I'm surprised how well this turned out for like what, 15 minutes of work? That is definitely something I want to try and explore further. This is of course in no way a production ready result and I'll want to try and iron out some of the kinks, but like I said, for such a minimal effort, I'm really happy with the results so far. Having said that, I just had another idea. Why not use camera clipping planes instead? That would eliminate the need for layering and all that nonsense. I set each camera's culling mask back to rendering everything, and I customized the clipping planes to the same distance as previously. Now I get a slightly different result. The cutoff point is not geometry, but depth based. And I just love how some objects get cut in half now, like this car here. But I don't really like how we get empty space in between the cuts. So what we can do is to set all our camera's near clipping values back to 0, but keep the far clipping plane as is. That way we'll get repeating geometry but we'll get rid of those nasty cracks, which would make for a more rounded out look. Okay, what else can we do? We can render the scene in its entirety by setting each camera's clipping plane back to default values, and just rendering everything on top without clearing depth. This makes for such a freaky glitch effect that I can't get enough of for some reason. You do end up rendering the whole scene 4 times and it's surely a performance dump. But hey, we're prototyping, and in prototyping everything goes. How about we change the FOV of our cameras independently, to drive the psychedelic point home even more? Again, I would not consider this effect quote-unquote production ready, but look how much variation you can get just by playing around with a single Unity feature and taking it out of the context it was built for. I'm sure there's loads more we can try to do, but I feel like I stumbled upon something and I want to try to recreate one of the effects in a more proper kind of way. Circling back a few experiments, I really love the idea behind this bendy world effect, so I want to give it a shot recreating it in Shader, and to complicate our life even further, we'll use Shader Graph to build it out. I don't wanna bore you with details, so let's rapid fire around this. First, we create a helper script which will communicate to the shader the exact amount of bend needed to be applied. As we're not using additional cameras anymore, I create an empty quaternion instead. It will hold the rotation of our imaginary delayed camera, and by comparing the rotations between the two, I'll be able to figure out the exact angle difference on each of the axes, which in turn will tell me how much of the bend must be applied and in which direction. At this moment I am going with a pretty cut and dry solution to figure out the angles, and because of how Euler angles work, some transformation is needed, otherwise the numbers will jump to the opposite direction when the camera crosses the horizon point. But this approach will change once we get a tad more complicated. Everything looks fine to me and it seems like the script is doing the job, so let's move on. I'm gonna use the shader made earlier, as it's already applied to all of the objects in this scene, making my life that much easier. If you're adamant about diving into shaders, I have an in-depth tutorial to get you started, but this is all pretty basic stuff and you don't need to worry. First order of business is to find out the distance to any given vertex and make some input parameters to handle the size of the curvature. Having that information, I calculate the offset of the x and y axes and add that number to the vertex base position. Once again, if you've never dealt with shaders before, I assure you, this sounds way more complicated than it actually is. And alright, the shader seems to work. There are some artifacts here and there, but nothing we can't fix down the line. Now it's time to make the script pass the calculated angle value to the shader, so that the bend will be automatically applied when we control our camera in the play mode. The scene uses quite a few materials, so I made a list to iterate over all of them. And here are the first real-world results. Quite raw and twitchy for my taste, but hey, at least it's alive. I did spend a good amount of time trying to figure out why was I having these shadow artifacts. It's as if the vertex shading was happening after the shadows were calculated, but that can't be true. So after fiddling some more I did find the culprit. Turns out working in view space for some reason caused the artifacts to appear. Once I switched to regular world space, everything returned to normal. But that did mean that I had to reassess my approach on how to bend the scene. So I reworked my graph, treating the horizontal and vertical logic separately, with a few additional nodes. This gave me finer control over the behavior of the bend, which is great, but that also meant that I needed to rework my script as well. Which is a good thing, to be honest too, because I finally got rid of that Euler mess of a code and replaced it with a much more robust sine angle solution. And went as far as adding a second virtual camera to make the overall movement in the scene much more float-like. But there was still one issue left. Notice how the objects close to the edge of the screen disappear while mid-bend? It happens because while we are indeed moving the vertices around, the bounding box of the object remains the same, and that is what the camera uses to cull objects off the screen. So a huge shout out to Nir Lahat from NotSlot Games, who masterfully demonstrated how to expand the frustum culling to compensate for the changes we are doing. And finally, this is the result. Not only have I experimented a lot and got pretty comfortable working with multiple cameras, but it also led me to making this shader, which in the end took me, I don't know, about 20 times longer than the camera stacking solution that brought me here, And I can strongly say that I would not have thought or had the bravery to make this shader if not for all the fooling around. Here's the final C-sharp script that goes on camera. And here's the final shader graph if anyone's interested. These files are available for free to anyone by following a link in the description to my Patreon. Of course, I can't ship them with any of these amazing assets, so you'll have to play around with your own geometry. But if you like some asset, links are in the description too. Finally, if you really want to pursue the idea of making banded or rounded world, check out this amazing asset on the asset store, which is miles ahead of what I've built here. And check out this rounded world tutorial right here on YouTube. Alright, you know what to do, smash like, subscribe and slap, and I'll see you soon with some more devlogs and tutorials. Peace out.